welcome. It's really wonderful to have you here. Let's give Chris a round of applause.
Thanks, Crystal. So it's an interesting discussion today. So I will speak to you literally as I stand here. I don't have a speech worked out. Generally, I don't. I think today even more so. So I will address today's time in three components. The one is I'm going to tell you certain facts that you need to know. Second is I want to share with you my journey. It's not necessarily going to be what you want to hear, and as you know me by now, there's always a link to my spirituality and the way that I've lived with my amazing God and Lord. So we'll learn about that. Just a note that when I talk about that, I'm not here to try and convince anybody about your faith. It's really sharing my story. So just see it in that light. And then lastly, you may have lots of questions. So you're then welcome to ask questions, and hopefully we won't leave here today without all those questions answered. So you may have heard rumors that I resigned. I have, in fact, resigned last week Wednesday. This will be my last formal leadership session as the CEO of AFCRI. And I will, continue supporting the role or the people coming in for another year until 2021. The facts are that Tinus, raise your hand, has been asked by the shareholders to lead you in the capacity of an acting CEO. The second fact is that they have requested and negotiated with Johan Giel to come back as a chief operating officer. Johan will join in 3 months. He resigned from GWK, I believe, yesterday or the day before. And lastly, the fact is that I'm not disappearing. I think that it's important to understand that you still have amazing shareholders. You still have amazing people in this company. And one company can never be about one person. It can never be just me. Yes, I've given direction to the best of what I know, to inspiration that I felt I received from the Lord over 11 years. But in that, there's also a journey. You know, there's a journey that one needs to know, and there's a journey that one needs to understand. So, interesting, life is a journey. You know, you start off when you see light, and then you pass away if the Lord blesses you at the age of 80 or 90. But life is broken up in different journeys, you know, and when one journey comes to an end, it doesn't necessarily mean that the next journey is going to be bad or less exciting than the one you currently have. My time and the way that you need to understand me is that my journey started with the Lord as a 17-year-old child when He changed my life. And ever since then, He has placed something in my heart about people, or for people. He's given me an amazing love for people and for the people of Africa and for making a change in the lives of people in Africa. I don't know why, but He took me on a journey through merchant banking. I spent 14 years in merchant banking, for those of you who don't know. 7 years in Standard Merchant Bank, 7 years in Absa Corporate Merchant Bank, of which 3 years, or almost 3 years, was in New York, working for their New York office. And in that time, He did nothing else than really just train me for what He wants me to do for Africa. So in that time, I couldn't ask for a better learning curve. Some very difficult times, some very positive times, but ultimately I learned a lot. So a lot of the experience that I carried into AFCRI came from that time, whether it's spiritual experience or whether it's physical experience. In AFCRI, I started a new journey. It was an interesting time for me because at the time, you know, Jeff was still CEO. I came in 2005, 1st of June 2005. My very first day, I met Yolandi. Yolandi, where are you? She took me around. I was actually early. I thought, you know, it's farmers. We start early in the morning. It worked out that most people come later. And it's the first time I actually see people coming to the job with shorts and T-shirts. Because in the banking industry, I was used to the way Peter Barnes dressed, which was a tie and a suit. But coming here, it was amazing how to experience new faces and how to experience new people. And Yolandi took me around that morning and introduced me to the people of AFCRI Financial Services, which is where I started, which was actually an amazing thing for me because a lot of the people still around this room are people coming from that era, people that I know for 15 years, people that I met during that time. And I think, in a sense, I had amazing blessing with Ellen as my PA. Ellen, you know, stood with me for a long time, went through up and downs, and then resigned. And it took me a long time to finally find Maurice, who's obviously supporting me in whichever way she can. But I think for me, the journey was not about me. The journey was, how can we position AFCRI in a place where AFCRI can make a difference in people's lives? You will see when I became CEO 1st of October in 2008 that my journey of positioning a company was about that. It was trying to find a platform where we can have an impact in people's lives. Whether it's customers, whether it's a small-scale farmer, whether it's a commercial farmer buying from hinterland or hopefully now town and country again. All that we did was using the information that we had at that point in time, praying about it and making a decision for that point in time, and hopefully creating something that will last past me. You may remember in many times I said that what we create here is above me, it's generational. So hopefully the next generation of leaders can take it forward. And the interesting thing for me is when you get to a point at the end of a journey, to understand really what the next journey is about is not always that easy. And I think that's where I found myself today. And what I learned is it's not necessarily for me to know, to be quite honest. It's not necessarily for me to understand. Yes, life is such that you want to understand. You want to know, you know, if you look at the birth of a baby, you know, it's easy when it's a cesarean. Is that what you call it? Because then you have a planned date, you have a time, you go in, the doctor does it. You know, it becomes more understandable than a natural birth. But sometimes when a natural birth happens, we don't necessarily understand the timing of that. And we don't necessarily understand when that next phase of a journey in somebody's life starts. And that is where I am today. Is the Lord has come to me and my next life starts. And I haven't resigned because of somebody or because of a person or because of, you know, something happening in AFCRI. I resigned because the Lord has opened the door for me and He started a new journey for me. And I can't, as a result of Him choosing for me to go into a new journey, actually decide to stay behind an old one. Because then you become lifeless, to be quite honest. If the time for you is to walk through a new door, you can't try and remain in the old one because you start to lose your excitement. You start to lose your journey. You start to lose the things that care for you. And I think that's where I... Do I know where I'm going? Not everything, certainly not. Do I have a glimpse of a light in a tunnel? Yes, of course, because the Lord is faithful and has given me amazing words since last week Wednesday. So for me, I need to share this with you because you will hear a lot of stories potentially and you will hear many things. But for me, it's really just starting a new journey. For me, it's really just being faithful to what the Lord is saying to me now. It's understanding where I'm going. It's understanding where that leads me and where that the passion that is given in my heart for people, how to lift that out beyond the borders of this entity. And that is where I am. So for 11 years, so it's interesting, in my life, the number 11, I think the spiritual meaning for 11 is the start of something new. I don't know exactly the wording. I have looked it up many, many, many years ago. But the number 11 was always quite significant for me in my life. And looking back, it's amazing how the Lord has actually confirmed that number for me again. And it's silly things, and you might think, okay, well, Chris, you're a bit weird. Why is 11 important? I am weird, but it's confirmation. You see, in a journey, what you need is confirmation. It's somebody saying to you, you know, this direction is correct. Now, a lot of people, a lot of you, me too, will base that confirmation on individuals. What I love to do, and the most peace that I can get in my heart is when that confirmation comes from the Lord directly. Of course he can do that through people in my life, but it needs to be a word from him. You know, I've shared in a conference at the end of 2017 about walking on water. And it's interesting for me, in that passage in the Bible where it described Peter getting out of the boat and walking on the water, that he was the only one that actually asked, "Lord, if it's you, tell me and I can walk away, I can come to you." He was the only one out of 12 disciples. And I think sometimes we lack the understanding of just asking. Just asking for that word of confirmation or that start of the new journey. And when coming back to the 11, so when I took my family in 2002 and APSA offered me a position in New York, so I left here. We arrived on the 11th of August 2002. The time, it was a new beginning for me. The time when we came back, we left New York 11th December 2004. So there's many other reflections I can tell you about the 11th. But it's interesting, I came back and the Lord has given me an amazing dream over December, talking about a new life. And when I came back one Saturday, I decided I must, before everything starts, I must clean my office. So I came out Saturday, the people who knows me, I put on my music quite hard, there was nobody in the office. And I listened music and I cleaned out my office. And when I left here, at the end of that process, which was about 4.5 hours, I did it alone. My peer didn't want to come and support me or no, it was sad. I'm just joking. So I cleaned out my office and I felt I should pray about the dream that the Lord has showed me in December about the new life. I prayed about it and I walked down, I got into my car and I left. And when I drove up to get out of the gate, randomly the question came to my head. I wonder what date it is. It was the 11th of January 2020. As you may know, today I'm CEO 11 years and 4 months. So for me, yes, it may sound weird to you, but the Lord has given me certain confirmations that He's opening a new door for me. So even though there may be many stories out there, I'm not a person that really worry about stories. The important thing for me is that you understand that I'm not angry at anybody for leaving here. I'm leaving because the Lord is starting a new journey in my life. And I want you to understand that. Because if you understand that, you understand my being and you understand where the company is going. Then you won't be worried about the future of the company because nothing is going to happen. You know, we're going to bring in, Dennis is an amazing person. I've said that many times. Johan is an amazing person. He used to work for me before he left for GWK. So I know the two of them for a long time. And the rest of you are amazing people. You know, so having, you know, we were able to grow the company from, I think when I joined, 2,800 people to where today we're just over 7,000 people. So, and that for me is life. That for me is creating a family where people can belong, they can look after one another, and they can be accountable. And that's what I want you to continue to do. Life in AFCRI is not about me. It's about what you do about AFCRI and how you drive it and how you position it and what you make of it. My time here is up, but my time in food and food security in Africa is not up. The Lord has given me, when I joined AFCRI, and even long before you, I want to share this dream with you as well, or vision. I had a vision when I arrived on the 11th of August 2002 in New York. I saw a vision of a sugar bowl, but a huge one. So it's when you watch these animated movies, you know, these little people, and you have this huge bowl in front of you and this huge spoon, and I was taking the spoon and I was feeding people. That was back in 2002. Long story short is, APSA at that stage wanted to buy a company in New York. I was then seconded by the bank to run that for them or to be part of it, and then the Reserve Bank didn't approve it at that point in time. So I found myself in New York and had to build a business from scratch, which took us about 2 years. But in that time, I felt the Lord saying to me that I should write a business case about food security. So this is back in 2002. And some of you may have heard the story, so I apologize if you hear it again. But in that time, in writing that, I thought by myself, you know, what is this and why do I have to do that? But So for me, I don't see myself as having the right to question the Lord. I'm not big enough or strong enough or high enough to question what He wants me to do. So I take His words and His visions and His dreams, you know, as it comes, and I believe in that. And at that point in time, I took the time and I wrote a business case. I said, Lord, here's the business case. About 3 weeks later, I felt I should design a logo for this. Now I'm sitting in an office in New York, a Boothian from Potis. No, not a Boothian. Actually, my father worked for the railways. But in any way, but the very small guy from Potis, and I sit here in New York, and the only reason why I got here is because the Lord took control over my life. And at that point in time, the logo I designed was a sword with a piece of material that's unveiling. And it really speaks about food security and storehouses in Africa. So fast forward to 2008, where my journey took me to AFCRI, and I got here and Jeff resigned. And I didn't apply for the CEO's position. The chairman came to me in July 2008, and he asked me whether I wouldn't want to be part of the process, and I said obviously yes. I went back to my wife and I said, now we have to pray. Because there were about 8-9 people on the shortlist, and I was one of them, but I thought by myself it would be unfair to go through a journey and then somehow get picked, and then I tell the people I need to go and pray about it, because it was a listed entity. So in that prayer, a friend of mine again gave me confirmation from the Lord saying that I must allow Him to appoint me where He wants me to be. So that was already halfway into the process. But at that point, I knew already that the Lord is going to give me this position because He wants me to do something for Him. In 2000, before the decision was taken, I had my 40th birthday, and a friend of mine came to me. My wife gave me a function, and this friend of mine said to me, now this was 2008, 6 years after I drafted that business case. And this friend of mine came to me and he said, I don't know why, but I felt in my spirit the Lord says I must give you this present. And he gave me such a big sword that looks very similar to the one that I designed in 2002. It wasn't about me, and being here is not about me. It's about what the Lord wants to do in feeding people in Africa. The ability that I had and the amazing grace from the shareholders to try and position that and have impact in the people of Africa, I will forever be grateful. I think the way that they've done it is unbelievable. Supporting me, at that stage it was a listed entity, gone on to a process where we delisted the company so that we can get long-term investors in. I got to Prem and to Paul and Mike and Fairfax, and it's unbelievable the support they've given me. So I have nothing else to say to them other than thank you. Because for me, they've allowed me time to position this company. And I do believe that what you have in this company is going to be great for the people of Africa in years to come. What I can do is follow my heart and then get to a point where I decide what is the next door, what is the next part of the journey. What I know for a fact is that I will be involved in food and ag, that I will continue my dream of supporting people and driving food security and making a difference. And how I'm going to do that, in what form I'm going to do, I don't know. But I know it's going to be bigger than what I know now. And that is my story. It's unfortunate, and I apologize for those people who don't necessarily understand the way that I walk with the Lord. I don't expect you to understand. Faith is a very personal thing. But faith is born out of understanding, it's born out of love. And if you don't have that, it's sometimes very difficult to believe. Krista asked me to speak about expectation. And I think it's so relevant because when I said to her, I can't even remember when I commit to this thing, but it was long before this decision was taken. And I think in that story of trying to understand the expectation of a new journey, is the one thing I learned is you should never limit yourself in the expectation of yourself, the expectation of what you're doing, and the expectation of where you're going. Because the fact, and I said it many times to you, and some of you may have heard it, some of you may have forgotten it, the fact is that whatever you expect is where you're going to end up. So if you expect, we will never reach more than what our expectations are. So if I can do one thing today is to beg you to never limit your expectations over your life, over your children, over your family, over your workplace. Because whatever you're going to expect is what you're going to end up with. The man can never reach beyond what his expectation is. Except if the Lord comes and he moves that pole, that expectation of yourself. Whichever, sometimes it happens through an interaction, sometimes it happens through prayer, sometimes it happens through a friend telling you something, but something needs to click in your brain that, you know what, I can actually expect more. I want to share a story with you. So I came from a poor family, fantastic parents, but not, I was the youngest of five, or I am the youngest of five. And I started off Standard Merchant Bank, really the lowest level that you can get, because I studied theology, my first degree, and then I had to get into a banking environment. And I really weren't paid well, which is fine. So I ended up in huge debt after 3-4 years, and I started praying about it. And I said to the Lord, you know, why don't you just give me, you know, I'll borrow from you, you know, 600,000 rand. I'll pay off all my debt. And then I can pay you back over my life. Sounds like a good deal. But in any event, so I started praying about my salary, and the Lord said to me, but Chris, what is your expectation? That's so when I tell you that the Lord said to me, that is what drops in my spirit. That's the way that I experience it. So the question dropped in my spirit. So what is your expectation? I said, sure. You know, if I can, I think my salary those days were 1,800 rand a month or something. So I said to him, Lord, if you can give me 200,000-300,000 a year, be amazing. He said to me, so what about 2-3 million a year? But the moment, the thing is, whether I got it 2 years later or 5 years later, the thing is, when he said it, immediately my expectation changed of that scenario. And when you look at life and when you look at your journey that you're in now, your journey can last for another 5 years, it can end in a week, it can end in a day. Ask yourself the question from a peer leading your own life, what is my expectation for this part of my journey? And when you have the answer to that, then you go and pray to the Lord and say, Lord, what's your expectation for me in this journey? Because I can tell you now, the only one that can mold your heart, the only one that can change your heart to have a different expectation is He. Mentally, we can do it. Mentally, we can say, you know what? We can have a budget of 100 rand instead of 10 rand. You know, but what is your expectation? Do you really believe that? It's interesting. It's very rare. I've been in AFCRI now, and I've been in budget, doing budgets for the biggest part of my life. But very few times have I seen people setting a budget and actually beating that budget. Because the budget sets a ceiling immediately that you agree to it. I've actually spoke to Fairfax in my second year, and I said to them, would they allow me to take budgets away completely? And then immediately I had the accountants, we need to load something in the system. We can't not have a budget. And obviously Louis von Zierner was also, well, it makes sense, but yeah. So, but the reality is you set your target the way that you think you can reach it. You never set a target for the impossibility, because we're all worried that if we can't reach the impossibility, then, you know, we're going to be fired, or we're not going to make the bonus we want to, or not going to get the increase. And that's how we operate as beings. There's a Maurice, I came back one holiday and she put up next to my wall, it's impossible until it's done. It's something that Nelson Mandela said. It always looks impossible until it's done. And that is something that you really need to understand. That is something that you really need to buy. And so if you can, maybe sometime today, take 10 minutes and think about it. Because what Nelson Mandela said and why I said it is because many things that will come across our paths, whether it's a new journey, it's a new door that opens, it's going to look impossible. But you're the one that can do it. And you can only do it if you expect that you can do it. If you don't expect that you can do it, you're not going to be able to do it. And that's my story for today. So I can understand whether there's a lot of question marks about the future, a lot of question marks about me. As I said, I committed to the group for another 12 months. I'll be helping Tinus if he needs my help. But Tinus, I don't think you need my help. So I'll be waiting for Johan. I'll still be in my office and around for some time. And hopefully I won't be here too long, because in a sense, it's also important for me to start release. You know, I can't, even though I love all of you, I love all the people in AFCRI. Yes, sometimes, you know, people irritate me. Where's Ross? You know, Ross can ask so many questions sometimes. And at some point I say, Ross, just do it, you know. But it doesn't mean I don't love him. And the same with you guys. It doesn't mean that's my heart. My heart is to love people. And I think if you understand that, then you understand my journey. Any questions? Yes. Yes, welcome.
I think I'm proud of my wife.
Ek waardeer dit. Enig iemand anders wat iets wil sê of kommentaar? So liefde is iets wat kom uit die hart uit. Liefde kan nie uit die kop uitkom nie. En ek waardeer dit wat jy het sê, want dis wat ek ervaar. Nie net in AFCRI, maar ook in die industrie. Ek het al met 'n paar mense gepraat vir die ondersteuning wat ek kry, mense wat vir my vra om betrokke te bly en in die instituut te bly, is regtig amazing. Ek het een of twee beleggers gevra in die gehad wat my genade het in die industrie om saam met hulle iets te doen. Maar ek dink die belangrikste vir my is nie om my journey self te design nie. En die verskillende journeys wat ek gehad het, en wat mense ook moet verstaan, binne in een journey is daar baie keer opgebreek in plomp klein journeys. Binne in AFCRI my 11 jaar as CEO, het ek 'n journey gehad om die bank te koop. En dit was 'n miraculous event gewees vir ons om die bank te koop. That would never have happened if it was not for the Lord's running that process. So we had different journeys, and each one of them, I can tell you so many stories of miracles happening in this building and in this company over the last 11 years that blew my mind. But the biggest one is the love among the people. If there's one thing, I came in a culture that it was okay to lie, in a culture that, you know, just get the deal done, the customer will never know. It probably took me 3 years to change the culture to one to understand that a good deal is where you open and transparent with the customer, he knows what the pricing is, and he buys into it. And also among ourselves, you know, just to understand where we are. And it's probably the most difficult. There's a saying in leadership that culture eats strategy for breakfast. And it's so true. You can have the best ideas, you can have the best strategies. If you don't have a culture that supports the people, you will always fail. And I've seen it many times over. And it's interesting that the people driving that will never recognize it. They will see their failures, but they will never know why. Culture is very important. My culture that I said to the Exco actually in the very first meeting we had in early January is that, you know what, I felt in a sense that over the last 2 years we lost a bit of that relationship culture that I always loved. That family culture that is so important for me. And I said to him, that's the one thing in this year we need to get back. We need to get back to that understanding that we all want family, we all want relationship. And that's born out of love. Love for one another, respect for one another. We all make mistakes. I've made plenty. I do, I have. I've invested in something and we've written off 6 million rand 5 years ago. But you know what, through that, if you can stand still and you can analyze why you've made that mistake, then it's great. Then you can learn from that. Then you invest in something in 200 million rand and it makes money. So that's how you learn. So we do make mistakes. And in that journey that you start, you're always going to make mistakes. And it's never to go down with a mistake. It's how you tackle the next opportunity. But it should all be born out of love. Yes. Enig iemand anders?
Anybody else?
Joel, nothing.
Yeah.
It's my last time you will see me here, so you must ask questions now. Otherwise, I'm going to feel you're not interested. William?
So on second date, Chris, for us, and yeah, it's business as usual. I mean, we had a lot of vessel, and die selle kan maar weer gebeur. Met tieners wat aan boord kom, allemaal ken hom gelukkig. So ek dink ons is positief. Ek dink net van my kant af om te weet, ek het nog nooit by jou voorbij gestap in hierdie gebouw wat jy my nie gegroet het nie. Dit is nie elke plek wat so werk.
Ja, ek waardeer dit.
Dankie vir jou leiding en dit is goed vir ons.
Ek waardeer dit. Ek moet sê, ek vergeet baie jou naam. So as ek jou dalk 'n ander naam genoem het, dan... Ek het agtergekom na 50, is nie so maklik nie. Maar Wasila, I remember your name. Is it right, eh? Yeah. And your boys are almost done with Vasti. Yeah, that's awesome. So she's one of the ladies I met when I started in financial services 15 years ago. With youngsters. Now my children are also out of Vasti. Well, in Vasti. Goosen, wat sê jy?
Ja, Chris, ek dink, soos wie hem ook gesê, ek dink van ons allemaal sy kant af, dankie vir jou leierskap, en jou bereidheid om jou geestelike pad met ons te deel. Ek dink, dit staan vir ons uit, en dit is vir ons een groot motivering en inspiratie.
Bedien.
En so seën toe vir die toekomst.
Amen.
Wat ek van jou uitspreek, jou beste daal hier nog voor.
Ja, dankie. So, Shanae, ek weet nie of Shanae is nie, ek dink nie sy is hier nie, maar Shanae, daar is jy. So, as Shanae kom, my kantoor ingestap, en sy sê vir my, Chris, hier is jou jaar. En 2 dae later toe bedank ek. So, Shanae, dit was profetes, en hier bevestig Goos in dit nou. So, dit is exciting, maar ek waardeer dit, Goos, en dankie vir die blessing, ek vat dit. Theo, wat sê jy?
Chris, dankie.
Ek wil net sê, jy kan nou op een complimente gee, so, ek gaan begin skuldig voel.
Dankie vir die tyd dat ek so met jou kon weer
gerust. Ja, is 'n groot blessing.
Goed geleer
vir jou. Ja, groot blessing. Ek het by julle ook geleer. Ek kan onthou, ek het by financial services begin het, was dit in 'n bietjie van 'n toestand gewees. Ek dink ons het daai jaar 8 miljoen verlies gemaak, en ons het 42 miljoen so voorsienings afgeskryf vir debiteure, en my eerste ding wat ek gedoen het, nou kom ek uit die bank uit, is ek het nog nooit in my lewe Afrikaanse memo geskryf nie. Toen moest ek Afrikaanse memo skryf, en die eerste ding wat in my kop opkom, maar vraag die mense, en ek het randomly vir Ellen gevra, jy weet, piek randomly 20 mense, bring vir my die naamlys, ek het randomly 20 mense gekies, en ek het interviews met hulle gehou, want jy weet die wat, nee, jy leer meer as jy luister, as wat jy praat. En ek dink dit is die belangrike ding, en die mense weet altyd beter. Ek kan jou nou vraag, ek kan na enige besigheid toe gaan in Afrika, wat verlies maak. En ek kan die mense op die grond gaan vraag, asof my precies sê wat is fout. En ek het dit gesien met Cobium. Ek meen, ons het nacht gehad in Cobium, maar ek terug in 2017. En die eerste ding wat hom had opgegeven, vraag die mense, en ek het gaan sit met 15, 12 mense, en ek meen, hulle het vir my precies gesê wat fout is. En dit is waar dit gaan. Jy moet onthou, as 'n CEO, my werk as CEO en Tinus werk as CEO is om direction te gee. Ek rely heavily op die onderliggende besighede CEO's of MD's om die besighede te ran. Ek kan nie vir William of vir ATM sê, dis hoeveel voorraad julle moet koop nie. Ek het nie 'n clue nie. Ek kan hulle uittrap as hulle te veel koop aan die einde van die jaar. En die rente is te hoog. Maar ek het nie, ek kan dit nie doen nie. So as 'n groep CEO is my fokus om mense te vertrou. En mense het my al teleurgestel, dit is waar, baie. Maar die probleem is, wanneer jy dan by 'n punt kom waar daar besigheid sleg doen, the only thing that you can do is ask the people in the business. Not even the management, I'll skip the management. Because they tell you what you want to hear. You go to the people, you ask them, they know. But I appreciate that. Wie wil nog iets sê? Is jy tyd? Lona? Nothing?
I think you made a comment earlier about making mistakes in AFRI, and I think I've made some improvements, and I think AFRI is stuck by me, and I think in return, really hope to see that.
Yeah.
I'm not going to say thank you, because that's been said.
I appreciate that. So mistakes is made, but there's a reaction needed on mistakes, and that's forgiveness. And if you can live up to your mistakes and you can ask forgiveness, or you can go back to the drawing board and you can start over, then it's awesome. And I always said to the people reporting to me, I hate surprises. So the worst thing is, I should tell you the story. So I started in October. I started in June, 1st June, and we lent money to Pride Milling at that point in time, and Yuri knows the story. And they had a bit of a hedge issue on Safex in 2005. And I had my first AFCRI holiday, and I think it was about the 17th or 18th of December down at the coast, and Jeff phoned me and he said, Chris, you have this problem. So in that process, nobody in my department at that point in time told me about it. I had to get a call from the group CEO to tell me he has a problem. And I think that at that point in time, I realized you should never have surprises. So if you see something going wrong, it's better to go to somebody and say, look, you know what, here's a problem. This thing is going to run into the wall. Please, can we do something? Especially the more difficult it is when you did it, when you made that decision. But it's still the best case, because if you bring it to the front, we can all work about it. You know, we can all see, okay, how do we manage that risk? How do we protect the company? If you don't, then it becomes a problem. Dennis, what do you say? Okay.
Can I get
you? Yeah, you're welcome.
I think for me, a defining moment in our history was 3 years ago when Chris went on his knees here in the front, in the foyer. And I've reminded Chris this morning of that. He said that a man that bows his knees in front of the Lord can stand before anybody. And I will never forget that day Chris asked the Lord to destine this business into the purpose and destiny that He has for us. And maybe the picture have changed. Maybe the picture we had in mind with Chris being our leader have changed. But God's purposes for this business remains unchanged. Chris that day asked the Lord to forgive us for the racial discrimination that took place in this company. Something happened that day that transformed this business from the inside out. I still remember he asked that we will be people of excellence that love, care, and serve one another. And we were intentional from that moment on to say, how can we create a culture where we see those things? And I think as a group of people, obviously we're going through a cycle of change where we're saying, can this happen? What now? The only thing that we have is that each one of us can be sure of our purposes that remains unchanged, even if the picture changed. So from a culture point of view, Chris, I just want to salute you for what the presence, what you have stood for in our business. I know there are so many people that deeply respect you. And another thing that Chris asked that day, he said, Lord, please give us leaders that will walk in humility. And if I look at Tinus and we sum up Tinus's life, when he and Bongani spoke here at a previous leadership session, you can hear the words that has been spoken over Tinus. Tinus is a leader with humility. And I think the times we are walking into is the most important thing we can do is to be humble, to make sure what's coming out of our own mouths, because we can either speculate about the future. A city is destroyed by what the people are saying about it. Or we can choose to plant seeds of faith into the future of this organization. So Chris, thank you so much for who you are as a leader. We really release you into the purpose and destiny that God has got for you. And I know that He will guide your steps in every step you take. May you be blessed.
Thanks. I'm going to say one thing before you cut. So I had a discussion with somebody who's already booked their holidays for December. And I said to her that it's an amazing thing to look forward to December. But as you sit here today, you have the choice what your expectation and your thinking is going to be to December. You are the one, and when Crystal said it, you are the only one that can make the choice of how you're going to think about the future. If you're going to think about the future negatively, you're going to experience it negatively. If you're going to sit in circles discussing how bad things has done or what is wrong or what mistakes people are making, you're going to have trouble. But it's your choice. You're the only one that can decide how you're going to think about the future and how you're going to think about your expectation for the future and what you're going to expect from Tinus and the next leadership. Okay? Thank you very much. Enjoy the day.
Thank you.